morning, everyone. I'm glad to welcome you to First Baptist Church this morning. We are delighted that you're here. I would remind you that this morning is a communion Sunday, and if you did not pick up the elements from the table at the back, please do so. And this morning, we will be having our communion service at the beginning rather than at the end. So if you didn't pick them up, now would be the time to do so. We also have some special guests with us today. Harry Beeson, his claim to fame as being the husband of our own John Bond, is going to be taking pictures. So if you see someone on this video, so if you see someone moving around the auditorium this morning, perhaps you already saw them in your Sunday school classes. Harry has done some work on our website, helping us to bring it up to speed. And these pictures are going to be available to the guests on the website. I will tell you, if you would prefer that your image, your personal picture, does not appear on our website, or that your child's picture, we would not identify anyone, appear on our website, write an email or send a letter to the office so that we have it reminded if you would prefer not to be used. Otherwise, just know that if you don't tell us we can, we will. Okay? But we certainly want to respect your privacy, and if you don't want your picture to be fully used, your picture is going to be taken. It will only be in general, and unless you tell us we can, we may use it. But again, I would not think we can identify such. Remind you about the connection cards. If you're visiting with us today, we'd love for you to fill this out so that we know that you are here. If you have a prayer request, if you have information to share with the office, you change your address, your phone number, and send your phone, the connection card, put it in the offering plate or drop it off at the welcome center. And that will be helpful to us. Another busy week at First Baptist Church. You will once again notice that every single day, something will be happening here at First Baptist Church in our facility. We love when that happens. This is a month's week, so Wednesday months will meet in the morning, Wednesday evening, a lot of youth group praise Bible study. Friday night, and you might remember that our freezer burn was postponed due to impending bad weather this Friday night, 7 o'clock at Chris Anderson's home. Our freezer burn will happen for men and boys of all ages. We have a great time of fellowship. We have not burning lots of talents. We enjoy our time together. Saturday night will be a family gift night here. That's really an all-structured time for church members to get together. All those who call First Baptist Church home, set up tables, games are going to be played, snacks are shared. I think we have about 75 or 80 people here for that Saturday gift night. So again, if you have nothing to do on Saturday night, we'd love for you to come and just enjoy a time of fellowship together. I will tell you that there are a couple of cases of Dutch blitz going on. Sometimes you see the character of people that is very different from what you see here on Sunday morning, so it might be worth coming just to see that. In connection with our celebration of our new addition and facility, we will be having the Celebrate the Faithfulness of God with Jason Gray concert here at First Baptist on Saturday, March the 19th. We would encourage you to be here and invite your friends. There is no cost for that concert unless you want to participate in the meet and greet. It has a limited number of people. It also costs $10 for a special time with Jason Gray. As we look forward to Easter, our tradition of having Easter liturgies again provides a way that we would like to provide an Easter liturgy, decorate the sanctuary during Easter. I fill out that slip at the bottom of the bulletin. Let us know if you would like to honor or remember. If we mention that Easter liturgy is here and that at the end of the service, you will feel free to take that. As we turn prayer, a number of items to pray about. We praise the Lord that he's here this morning. St. Anderson Andrew Clark came last week. It's worked very well, and it looks like the dedication is working well. So we praise the Lord for that. We ask that the Lord continue to be with saving. Fracture of a bone the other morning. Our kidney stones, various stages of that. So we'll be praying for those ladies, please. Something very simple. Return to the hospital tomorrow to begin intensive chemotherapy. And we certainly want to pray for those in our number who are having specific health issues. You know this, that we have a long list of folks with ongoing health issues that continue to thank you this morning for your Son, Jesus Christ, and thank you that in just a few moments we are going to be disobedient today by taking up the communion, the symbol of His body, the symbol of His blood given for us, so that we might be free from sin, so that the wrath of God would be satisfied. Relationship with Him can be reconciled. Father, thank you for this presence. Thank you for the freedom that we have in this country to meet in this way. Father, often we take that for granted. Take for granted the fact that we are able to gather in freedom and in peace. But we pray this morning for our brothers and sisters in Ukraine who aren't experiencing freedom. Peace, as even as we speak, they're in the midst of conflict, in the midst of battle, in the midst of loss, in the midst of destruction. God, give us the faith to let you be God. Remind us of the fact that you can be ultimately out of control. The fact that your word says that not one person comes to power outside of your decree. We may not understand what you're doing. We may not understand what you are fighting. But we do know that you have a master plan. We do know that master plan means that someday those of us who claim the name of Jesus will be gathered together. Jesus is, of what He has accomplished on our behalf, and of the hope that we have because of Him. So we would ask, Father, that you would have your way in our lives in this service, that you remove the distractions that so often cloud our minds, so that as we say, as we take it out like this, we open your way, we would be thinking of nothing but of your life itself.
Thank you.
Bible to offer this morning. You turn, please, to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. This morning, as a company of the Lord's people, we gather together at the Lord's table. I hope you understand, and I hope you know, and I hope you feel like we are about to do something that is very important. Jesus himself asked that we, his followers, would regularly remember him at the table of communion. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning with verse 23. I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The bread that we are about to take together is a symbol for it. Christ's body. Someone will pray and thank the Lord for the bread. And when we do so, we thank him for the symbol, we thank him for the picture, but in a very real way, we are also thanking God for the fact that he gave his son Jesus a body. The Lord Jesus had to have a body so that he could come. So that he could die. We thank God that Jesus made a body for the express purpose of him being able to give it as the perfect sacrifice for our sins. Paul goes on to write, verse 25, in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The cup, as Paul just said, and as we well know, represents the blood of the Lord Jesus, which was shed to satisfy the demands of a holy God. The shed blood of Jesus provides for us the means to enjoy the promises of the new covenant. Do you know what we're remembering this morning? Do you know that what we are proclaiming this morning? We're proclaiming that we, as followers of the Lord Jesus, now have our relationship with this holy God restored. And Jeremiah talks about the new covenant, he says that he will be our God. We will be his people. In the promises of the new covenant, the Bible says that all of us who are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ will know him. Isn't that exciting? A God like me can know a holy God. Jeremiah says that his law will be written on our hearts. Ever wonder why that's a promise of the new covenant, the fact that God's law would be written on our hearts? Well, that's a wonderful thing. That means not only will we know what it is, we will delight in doing it. You ever get tired of the struggle that Paul writes about in Romans 7? You know, the stuff that I want to do, I don't do, and the things that I don't want to do, that's what I do. One of these days, God's law will be written on our hearts in such a way that we will know what it is, and it will be our delight to do. And then there's that great final promise of the new covenant when it talks about our sin account, where God says, "I will forgive you your iniquity and your sin."
every time we come to the Lord's table, we proclaim His death. We proclaim the fact that we have a Savior. We proclaim the fact that Jesus died on the cross. He shed His blood. He rose again. We only do this until He comes. And as I described that this morning, as I described the fact that our sins are not only forgiven, but God chooses not to remember. As I described the fact that He longs to write His law on our heart, so not only will we know that we will do that. As I described the fact that God longs to have a real and personal relationship with you, that's a message that should be heard. Being reminded of that ought to bring us great joy and elicit praise and worship from our hearts. Not only do we look back at what He has done, we also acknowledge the fact that in His Word He promises that He will come again. So no matter how many times you've sat at the Lord's table, this is one less time that you will do. Until Jesus returns. The only stop that's out of what we get at the Lord's table, we stop there. We talk about the body, we talk about the blood, we talk about remembering, we talk about proclaiming it. We get to do it. The only stop. He says in verse 27, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and if so, do refuse to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself. If he does not judge the body rightly, for this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and the number sleep. In context, Paul is actually criticizing the communal practice of the Church of Corinth. The Church of Corinth observed the Lord's table or communion as part of a long feast. And in context of the First Baptist Church, you could think of a fellowship dinner. But what was happening in Corinth was some of the very wealthy people would buy their fancy meals and they would eat it quickly. And there were some people in Church of Corinth that weren't even able to bring a contribution to the love feast. And so you had some people who were eating it all and some people who weren't eating anything at all. And there were some people who were getting drunk. Did you know what that means in the Greek? Getting drunk. Can you imagine coming to the Lord's table to proclaim the Lord's death when you're inebriated? Can you imagine coming to have communion with your brothers and sisters in Christ, chewing all the food, and there are some people who have? The Church of Corinth was not loving God when coming to the Lord's table. And in the community of West, it was not loving God. Eating the food that you brought for your benefit and not sharing with your brothers and sisters is not loving your neighbor. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick. What we are about to do is a big deal. And God says, before you sit at this table, before we worship His Son, before we proclaim His death, the first thing that we need to do is to pray. It's interesting, the Bible talks an awful lot about having clean hands. And pure hearts. The psalmist says in Psalm 24, verses 3 and 4, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, and who may stand in His holy place? He who has clean hands in James chapter 4, verse 8. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your presence, it says. Purify your hearts. You better mind it. Jesus is giving his great sermon, the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, says, therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering before the altar. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come present your offering. We are offering to God this morning a sacrifice of praise, a sacrifice of obedience. Paul says, before you take the elements, before you eat the bread, for just a few moments so that we can examine God, the person next to you, so that I can examine my way. My name is clean. It's my heart pure. That's a beautiful thing that the Bible says, if we confess our sins. It is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Our hands can be clean and our hearts can be pure when we choose to repent, when we choose to confess. I think we have an opportunity to examine our hearts and ask ourselves the question, are we loving God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind? We could pause and ask ourselves the question, am I loving my neighbor well? We ask ourselves the question, is there anything that I need to make right with brother or sister or with God? You know, examining our hearts at the Lord's table is not designed to keep us away from the Lord's table. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to be. The purpose isn't to keep you away, the purpose is to draw you. Hebrews tells us that Jesus said, behold, I have come to do your will. The author goes on to write, by this will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Dear friends, will you give thanks for the bread which symbolizes the body of the Lord Jesus? Joseph first, but this time to Acts chapter 21. Book of Acts, chapter 21. Let's pick up reading this morning with verse 15, where the Bible says this. After these days, we got ready and started on our way to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea also came with us, taking us to Mason of Cyprus, a disciple of long standing with whom we worked along. After we arrived at Jerusalem, the brethren received us gladly. The following day, Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. After he had greeted them, he began to relate one by one the things which God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. And when they heard it, they began glorifying God. And they said to him, "You see, brother, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed, and they are all zealous for the law. A man had told about you, but you are teaching all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children, nor to walk according to the custom. What is to be done? They will certainly hear that you have come. Therefore, do this, that we tell you. We have four men who are under vow. Take them and purify yourself along with them, and pay their expenses, so that they may save the heads, and all will know that there is nothing to the things which they have been told about you, but that you yourself also walk orderly, keeping the law. But concerning the Gentiles who have believed, we read, having decided that they should abstain from being sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what is strangled and from fornication. Then Paul took them out, and the next day purified himself along with them, went into the temple, giving notice of the completion of the days of purification until the sacrifice was offered. Title of this morning's message is under the influence, and I hope when you saw that title, it made it grab you. And you wondered what in all the world is there a sermon at First Baptist Church about being under the influence. We talked about the church of Corinth, that actually some of those believers came to the Lord's table being under the influence. What does it mean to be under the influence? Well, when I'm trying to find the definition of a word, I have the same dictionary that I used in my college days. The Webster's not the New Collegiate Dictionary, it's not so there anymore. But it got me through college and graduate school and through my doctoral program, so I keep it on myself. It defines influence as the act or power of producing an effect or outcome without apparent exertion or force. Or it's the power exerted over our minds or the behavior. There are all sorts of things that influence us. Sometimes we are influenced in a positive way, and sometimes we are influenced in a negative way. And while this might not be the most exciting portion of Scripture that we're going to study in the book of Acts, I will submit to you, there are a number of influencers at play in what we just read about. I will also tell you that this is somewhat a controversial period in the life of the Apostle Paul. There are some biblical scholars that think the Apostle Paul made a major league mistake in what he did. There are other Bible teachers that would say, no, he did the exact right thing. This morning, for our benefit, I want us to think carefully about some of the influencers, and then we're going to have to make a decision as we leave this place. What is going to influence you? What is going to influence me? I want the first influence. It's from number one, the influence of Christian fellowship. The influence of Christian fellowship. You might remember that the last time we were with the Apostle Paul, he was in Caesarea, he was staying at the house of Philip the evangelist. Remember Agabus and Paul, and as the Apostle Paul for his belt, and then he tied that belt around his feet and his hands and said, the Holy Spirit says, this is what's going to happen to the person who owns this belt. Last week when we were together, the challenge was, did you have a will? And we were challenged as believers to make God's will our will. Remember those Christians begged Paul, don't go to Jerusalem, don't go. But he was determined because that's what God wanted him to do. And sure enough, as we look at our passage this morning, verse 15, after those days, we got ready and started on our way to Jerusalem. The Apostle Paul knew what he was going to do, and he takes this whole group, all of those people traveling with him. You remember who they were? Dr. Luke. Some of them are Aristarchus and Secundus and Gaius and Timothy and Philippus and Trophimus. Notice verse 16. And some of the disciples from Caesarea also came with us. Not only did he have his band of merry men that had been going with him on a missionary journey, because of the influence of Christian fellowship, there were other believers who were concerned about the Apostle Paul, who said, well, if you're determined to go to Jerusalem, we want to go too. The text of Scripture doesn't say why these disciples from Caesarea joined the Apostle Paul. But because they understood that he was going to face severe persecution and severe trials, I speculate that they probably wanted to travel with Paul to encourage him, to help him. And again, last week we talked about hospitality. They go to this guy Vincent's house. I have no idea why he's taking this stuff with him. He's getting this there for books and stuff. But all of this group is going to receive hospitality at his house. And notice what happens in verse 17. After we arrived in Jerusalem, the brethren received us gladly. For many of us, we don't really understand what this is like. We are part of First Baptist Church, and we come to First Baptist Church week in and week out, and we don't want to expect. When you travel alone, sometimes you have the opportunity of meeting with a brand new group of believers, Christians that you've never met before. One of two things that happened in my travels as I travel around, and I travel to a lot of local churches. I've been many local churches for the first time. There were some, actually, before, but there are some local churches where it was me, myself, and I in the local church. In some of those local churches, they even have a fellowship time with coffee and cups of coffee and cookies. And I have enjoyed many cups of coffee by myself in the corner of a gym or a fellowship hall. While all these other people are buzzing around and enjoying the church's company, I'm probably going to get my phone. Or I could walk into a church for the very first time, and those people who don't know me from heaven, because I'm a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, receive me. And they love me. So we were able to have this fellowship simply because they follow Jesus and I follow Jesus. And that's what happened here in Jerusalem. And I hope we, as the believers that make up First Baptist Church, are determined to be influenced by Christian fellowship. Sometimes I'll mention someone's name to someone else. You know, so-and-so at church, and they'll say, who? I don't know who you're talking about. And sometimes we're kind of laid back if we wait for someone new to come and talk to us. But guess what? You know what we can do? Crazy thing. If you political society where we've been kind of taught to assume the worst about people and tell them they can come up with it. But I wonder if that's really how we're supposed to respond as Christians. Maybe, just maybe, because of who Jesus is, we are supposed to assume the worst about someone until they prove otherwise. And when someone comes to us claiming to be a follower of the Lord Jesus, maybe we take them out. Now, I know what you're thinking, and I know what you might be saying. I used to say the same thing when growing up, where I want to find my brothers, and I used to get so angry at my dad. In fact, sometimes we think that my dad is right. Because all that someone has to be is claim to be a brother. So we would get sales and come forth one way. Just sell a few things to parts out of the back of my truck. I don't have money to get home. Yeah, I don't have money. Just hope. Just say, this is a big hole. All they have to do is say they're a good brother. You follow what they say. But here's the thing. Okay, I want you to believe that the Bible talks. I'm sure about my dad actually believed that his money was God's money. And I think when my dad stands to the judgment seat of Christ, I think he'll get a little better for trying to let brothers and sisters get home. I can't imagine the Lord Jesus at the judgment seat today. He met with James, who was probably the half-brother of Jesus. He met with all of the elders of the church. And by the way, don't forget that he was bringing an offering from the Gentile churches. We read about that in Romans chapter 15, verse 15 to 16. And he reported to them the things that God has done. In fact, the text of Scripture says he related to them one by one. Can you imagine what that would be like? He said, let me tell you what God has done. Let me tell you about that time I was let out the window of a casket. Let me tell you about that time I was stoned and left me for dead. Do you know that there was a time when people were taking my sweat cloth and my apron, and when it would touch someone, they would get healed? Let me tell you about me. I was preaching at this church, and you know, I'm not known for my short sermons, and I was preaching at that place. Midnight, this guy was sitting in the window sill. He fell out the window. He was laying down on the ground, graveyard dead. So what happened? He got raised from the dead, and we went right back and got the second guy. Let me tell you what God said. Wouldn't that have been wonderful? And it is in the text it says that they did exactly what we thought they would do. And when they heard, they became glorifying God. Wow! What does it mean to glorify God? Richard's definition of glorifying God is to enhance his reputation in the world. Wow! Isn't God good? Isn't it wonderful what he has done? That's what happens when Christians understand Christian fellowship. But we're influenced by the fact that we are following the same city. So first talking about the camp. You see, brother, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed, and they are all zealous for the law. And they have been told about you that you are teaching all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children nor walk according to the customs. Point number two, that's the influence of the Lord. The population of Jerusalem is estimated at this time to be between 30 and 50,000. And there were many Jews who, in the city of Jerusalem, had put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. They believed that he was the Messiah. They believed that he was the chosen one. In fact, the Bible talks about the zeal that were zealous. What does zealous mean? To be characterized by zeal. What is zeal? It's an eager or ardent interest or pursuit of something. Did you catch what these believing Jews were zealous for? Were zealous about? For what they believed. And think of their trust in Christ. They were most interested in. The most ardent about the greatest pursuit was the law. You know, the Bible does call upon us to be zealous people, to be eager and ardent in our interest and pursuit of something. You know what it is? Good works. Titus 2:14 tells us that we ought to be zealous for good works. 1 Corinthians 14:12 says that we should be zealous for spiritual gifts. And ultimately, we ought to have a zeal for God himself. But what were these Jewish believers zealous for? The law. Keeping the rules. Great difference between what they thought was true about Paul and what was actually true about Paul. Hey, Paul, you're teaching Jews to forsake Moses. You're telling them not to circumcise their children or walk according to their customs. That's what they heard about Paul, but what was really true? But we've studied the book of Acts. We've studied other Paul and his writings. You know that the Apostle Paul quotes the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, written by Moses, 45 times. He didn't forsake Moses. He talked about it a lot. His accusers are teaching Jews not to forsake, or not to circumcise their children, but do you remember the book of Acts 16? This is a quiz, and I asked you what the Paul did in the time of his Acts 16. The correct answer would be, he circumcised him. Did the Apostle Paul forsake the customs of the Jews? If I were to ask you, what was Paul's custom when he would go into a new city? He did the same places at every time, which was on the synagogue. He'd go to the synagogue on Saturday, and there he would discuss Scripture with them. There was what they thought and what was actually true. They had a solution, and they said, Paul, well, you know, Paul, we don't want anyone to be upset with you. We don't want anyone to think badly of you. So we have four Jewish people here that are at the end of their vow, most likely with a Nazarite question. And Paul, what you need to do is take them to the temple and purify yourself and purify them. And then you need to pay for their expenses because the sacrificial requirements for completed vow were pretty expensive. You read about that in Numbers chapter 6. Every number of animals that had to be sacrificed, great offerings that had to be offered. people will know that you by the way, if we do remember the decision of the Passover Council, verse 25, but concerning the Gentiles who have believed, we wrote, having decided that they should abstain from being sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what is strangled. Now, John, we have to decide why did James and the rest of the elders say that? And there are some biblical scholars who say that they are making it clear that they are not trying to salvation. I'm not so sure that they were being scriptural in their minds. Because they were clearly asking the Apostle Paul to be accepted, especially the free that he kept the Lord. Behind the dollars for every time I someone say, I know what I should do, but I can probably recover from the mistake of the Lord. And that's what the church of the Lord is saying. And so I know I'm going to be better than the Lord. I know what the Bible says, but I know God looks at the heart, but you better follow my address code. I know that music is a gift from God, but only the following three instruments are approved. I know what God says, but I know what we say, but. And what did the Apostle Paul do? Verse 26. Then Paul took the man, and the next day purified himself along with them, went down to the temple, giving notice of the completion of the days of purification until the sacrifice was offered for peace. Thirdly, this morning we see the influence of love. The influence. What did Paul do? He did exactly what James and the elders suggested he did. He went to great lengths to show himself a keeper of the law to pacify the people. Again, some scholars think the Apostle Paul basically has been doing this mistake. In fact, do you remember his confrontation with Peter? Remember that? In Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through 14, he talks about that confrontation with Peter, because Peter would come to Antioch. And when Peter was in Antioch alone, he was having great fellowship with Gentile believers. He was fellowshipping with them, he was eating with them. He believed them to be brothers and sisters in Christ. But you accept me. Accept my word for it. Look at Galatians chapter 2 this afternoon, and you'll find out that James from Jerusalem sends some Jewish Christians to Antioch. Peter and Peter then? When those people that James sent got there, and he contacts, hey, you want to meet at Burger King? He responds, no, I can't. I can't. Because all of a sudden, when all these other Jews were that he would count all of his accomplishments as rubbish that he may gain Christ, that he may know him. In Philippians 1, there were some people who were preaching the gospel out of envy and strife. He says they're not preaching for the right reasons, but I'm just grateful that the gospel is being preached. And then, in reference, he says he would give up his own salvation so that he could be saved. I think the reason that he put those four men into the temple went with all of that rigmarole and had to pay money out of his own pocket is because Corinthians chapter 9, he writes, to the Jews, I became as a Jew, so that I might win Jews. Those who are under the law, as under the law of them, not being myself under the law, so that I might win those who are under the law. He gave me to judge your fruits, according to what I said in the gospel. When you show me the truth. He gave me to judge. I've been invited to preach at churches that have told me, do not wear a suit. If you wear a suit, you will be at the point. But I always wear a suit. You know what I do? I don't wear a suit. I've been in churches that have said, we prefer that you only preach out of the kingdom. You know what I do if I get invited to preach at a church where I'm supposed to preach out of the kingdom? I preach out of the kingdom. What is it that causes you to think what you think and do what you do? I'd like to suggest this morning that you be like the Apostle Paul, and primarily the men and women who are influenced by love. The influence of Christ's love, which compels us to live for God. The influence of our love for Him. We love Him with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. We love Him with everything we've got. The influence of our love for fellow believers. We love Christian fellowship. We understand that we now have a capacity to love each other like Christ loved us. The influence of our love for the lost, which would cause us to do just about anything. To see a lost soul come to a saving knowledge. I hope that we as a local church will say, that you would continue to work in our hearts and our minds, and you would continue to change us. We started our service this morning by proclaiming the death of your Son, recognizing that we only do it until He comes. We proclaim that He came and He suffered and bled and died for our sins to appease a holy God. We claim this morning to be men and women who will be beneficiaries of the new covenant. Father, let the love of Christ compel us, motivate us, influence us. Today we see the Apostle Paul doing something that kind of surprised me, jumping through some hoops to keep some Jewish believers happy. And Lord, we could be critical and we could argue that we don't need to go into the temple. We don't need to make someone happier. We don't need to jump to the hoops yet. Paul seemingly willingly did. connection of the divine will be in the context with which we like to stop and pray and protect.